students speak out. We always look forward to this. And to everybody out there, happy Valentine's Day to you and your loved ones, and to the viewing audience, and to my, I'd give a shout out to my wife Carla, my daughters Cassandra and Kiara. Happy Valentine's Day, and I love you. Okay. No. Oh, it's Latonia's birthday? Oh, happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Latonia. Happy birthday to you. All right. Well, she is a sweetheart. Now, we're going to do this again when we go on regular session, too, so.
Yeah,
I know. Oh, where's Scott? I didn't see her, yeah? Oh, former school committee woman Carmen Rosa is here. I don't see her. She's in the back there. Hi, Carmen. Nice to see you. So we have Springfield Renaissance School is in the house. Victor Soto, Ziana Hardrick. If I pronounce your name wrong, please correct me. Alyssa Theriak, accompanied by Daniel Pear, who is the assistant principal. Come on down. You're all set. You're ready to rock and roll.
Hello, my name is Victor, and this is Alyssa. We are seventh grade students from the Springfield Renaissance School. We have come to talk to you today about our recent expedition and excellent participation during the expedition. Speaking of which, Renaissance has been following the Attendance Matters program, which gives students a better reason for a better education. Seventh grade has been knocking it out of the ballpark with continuous 97% or more attendance, which leads to a dressed-down day the next day.
Very good, Victor.
The expedition we followed was called A Long Walk to Water, Using Stories to Create Peace. This expedition was about reading a story called A Long Walk to Water and making a narrative about it. During this process, we interviewed refugees from South Sudan, which consisted of Wize, Adam, Mamanda, from the Second South Sudan Civil War.
Very good, Alyssa.
We also took a painstaking journey to different ponds and collected water. We then carried the water-filled containers back to our school and had a contest to see who could carry the most water back. To determine the winners, we separated ourselves by crew and brought our own belongings in. Some people brought small bottles, while others brought containers the size of coolers.
Indeed. As this was going on and we were making our narratives in ELA class, we were also making projects in science based off of an online packet that we received from our teacher. It was about the water supplies in South Sudan and how it can affect the way people live. We went into groups of three or four people who each had a certain section in a certain chapter of this packet. So, I'm sorry.
You're doing fine.
What we did was we each took our information and we shared it among our peers who put it into different packets, which were actual paper. After this, we put it onto a large poster in which we presented during the expedition celebration.
Very good, Alyssa.
After this pack was filled out, we got another piece of paper to fill out our partners' information. Once the process was done, we transferred it onto a poster, which was presented towards the end. We had parents, students from different grades, and people who wanted to check out our school come. During this time, we shared what we had worked on for a couple of months. Then we broke off into small groups of 10, where students would have either shared a piece of their narrative or a poem that was made in all the other classes.
In my narrative, my excerpt states, "It was torn and stained with blood, his and others being shed. They seemed like shorts on him now, most of the torn clothing on different parts of his body used to keep pressure on the wounds."
An excerpt from my narrative says, "I was born in a refugee camp because of the 1972 genocide in Africa, specifically Liberia. We weren't exactly living in the winter wonderland either. In fact, I have never seen snow until I came to America. It took a while because it was only June, but it soon started to come, day by day, month by month, year by year. We had no shoes anyway."
Furthermore, we spent a few months doing an extremely educational expedition. During this expedition, we used statistical information in order to make a narrative and poster, which can emphasize the details on South Sudan's civil war. I would like to thank the school committee for taking time out of their day to listen to multiple schools present their wondrous presentations.
I would also like to thank the 7th grade team for participating in the expedition and making a better pathway of understanding.
Great job. Thank you very much. Very thoughtful. And just for the record, our student rep, Delfina Zigwati, who does a great job, she's not here tonight because she's at senior night at the cheerleading for the girls' basketball team, Renaissance, and she's been a welcome addition to our school committee. So I knew you would like that. Renaissance student. STEM Middle Academy is in the house. Brianna Gendron-Jordan, James McKenzie, they are accompanied by Errol Green, Luis Martinez, principal I saw, 7th grade team leader, and Eduardo Martinez, assistant principal. Come on down. How you doing, kids?
Hello.
All right.
Hello. My name is James McKenzie, and
I'm Brianna Gendron-Jordan.
And we would like to start off by saying thank you to everyone in the audience and Barbara Gresham, Latanya Monroe Naylor, Maria Perez, Daniel J. Warwick, Mayor Dominic J. Sarno, Christopher Collins, Denise M. Hurst, and Addie Peter Murphy.
Thank you.
And everyone in the audience again. We are the 7th grade students of STEM, and we're here to tell you about some of the sustainable practices within our school. Our student body consists of roughly 300 students, and although we are a small school, we face the same challenges and needs as any other public middle school within the inner city. The one thing I can say about our school, STEM Middle Academy, is that we have and we are continuing to practice and incorporate daily routines and procedures that will make us a better school community as well as successful students. Every morning we start with our STEM pledge. We are crew, not passengers. We are the leader of our own learning. We are responsible and take charge of our own success. We collaborate and we achieve more when we work together. We strive for integrity and...
You're doing well.
And
we strive for excellence and work towards quality. We support literacy and global citizenship for all, science, technology, engineering, mathematics.
We are STEM.
This pledge.
Good. I wouldn't have remembered all that.
This pledge is embedded in our studies throughout the day. For example, our school habits of scholarship, which are I act responsibly, I collaborate, I show integrity, I innovate, and I strive for quality. These habits are continually stressed in our character learning targets, which are on the teacher's agenda board. Within a class structure, our teachers focus on providing us with rigorous tasks that make us as scholars more apt to be able to relate content to the real world. It basically enforces what we learn in class. It also is reiterated to students that you can retake assessments to show growth for a knowledge versus grades. Another one of STEM's sustainable classroom practices comes through a partnership with the High School of Science and Technology. Seniors come from the high school for a few periods throughout the week to help work with the students. This collaboration has been happening for the past couple of years with hope of continued sustained success. We as students appreciate having someone else to help us aid us because there's a lot more students than just one teacher.
Nice job, James. Brianna, you're up.
After school, club or teams have become a major part of STEM's makeup. Our most notable programs being a big brother or big sister partnership that we have through a collaboration with a mixture of high school students who are matched up with according to similarities. We are grateful to have them because they give us an outlet and we often share stories and experiences, and sometimes this support makes it easier with some of our everyday stresses in our daily lives. Sometimes our bigs, as we call them, will tutor us in our studies as well. Oftentimes we will eat snacks, play games, and just kick it, so it's pretty cool.
That's like a commercial break. We get it.
Another program we have at STEM is our Green Team Recycling Club. This team was established 3 years ago with the help of our nursing staff, ELL, sped teacher, and science department, with the goal of making a healthier, more environmental friendly school. The Green Team will help educate students on its students that can be recycled versus the ones that can't. As a school, we went from producing 80 pounds of compost to 120 pounds of compost. Last year, the Environmental Eagles presented STEM on behalf of the Green Team, an award for contributes to a cleaner, healthier environment. For every 1 pound of trash, we are diverting 8 pounds of compostable materials. One, we are reducing the amount of waste from STEM that makes it into our landfills. We generate healthier soil for our garden. We have two water bottle filler stations installed to reduce the need for plastic bottles. We reduce in volume of waste generated by STEM classrooms, and we grow enough healthy vegetables to share and create recipes as a Green Team. Changemakers is also an after-school program at STEM. Changemakers is a fully funded National Science Foundation, Boston College, and Springfield Public Schools collaborative project that seeks to spread the benefits of access to healthy food, knowledge of food justice, and increasing the understanding of our communities about the impacts our choices have on futures and the planet. Students are engaged in the production of healthy vegetables, herbs, and fruit. Students will become knowledgeable about the importance of food justice in the Springfield community's access to fresh and varied produce. Students will learn important STEM skills to help prepare them for college and beyond. Students are using GIS data maps, data analysis, geography, and student-collected data about their neighborhoods to identify community needs and areas for maximizing our potential positive effects. Students tasked with running the hydroponic farm, creating a business model to distribute our produce, and spreading the message of food justice throughout Springfield. There are multiple STEM facility members involved, as well as several HS science teachers from SciTech. Along with our dedicated faculty program is mentioned by the high school students, known as Food Justice Ambassadors, from within the SPS District High Schools. These are the Changemakers program students that will work directly with our collaborating facility at SciTech and will help mentor Changemaker Sprouts, the middle school students. This program is all about building sets of young scientists and entrepreneurs, as well as connecting with the knowledge, engaged, and proactive members of the Springfield food and access gardening communities. Our accomplishments are that we've built 7 student design, two tiered and float hydroponic farms, engaging our community in topics of food access and food justice in the city of Springfield, teaching applicable science skills needed to run a hydroponic farm, successfully produce fruits and vegetables, connecting student mentors, Changemaker food ambassadors, the high school students, and Changemaker Sprouts, the middle school students, receiving consistent yearly grant funding from the National Science Foundation and Boston College, working closely with a well-known Boston area college, Boston College, to collaborate on a large-scale project. Connect SPS students with the gardening community, Society of Women Engineers, and other networking opportunities throughout the state. Our future goals are to increase presence at local farmers markets and community events, teaching others in Springfield the benefits of healthy eating and creating their own access to healthy gardens and food, communicating the financial benefits of growing your family's food, engaging the different ethnic communities in Springfield through their cultural foods and dishes, growing herbs, spices, and vegetables to meet the diverse needs of different cultures that are unmet at local stores, becoming a meaningful and known voice for the healthy eating, healthy living habits, and greener choices in the Springfield community, to increase volume of healthy vegetables produced to share with our community, increasing volume of production to generate revenue through a successful business model, increasing attendance and cross-district collaboration between the school sites, faculty, and students. Once again, we thank you for having us and giving us the time to explain what we do in our school.
We are STEM.
Thank you very much, Brianna. Thank you. Very thorough. Thank you. Springfield Public Day, middle school's in the house. Andre Ferrero and is accompanied by Brianna Clancy and Joelle Sanford, SPED teachers. Come on down.
Good.
Andre Ferrero.
Good evening, Mayor, Superintendent, and the school committee members. My name is Andre Ferrero, and I am a seventh grader at Public Day Middle School. I came at the end of last school year, and it's a great school for me. My principal and counselor meet all the students at the buses, and it makes me feel welcomed at school. We also have a para at our school that makes sure to shake our hand and say good morning during check-in. It's little things like this that really make me enjoy going to school every day. My teachers are also very supportive of me and my classmates. This is shown by our increased Lexiles reading and iReady scores. These interventions really helped me improve my math and reading. My teachers encourage us to do our best and to increase our independence levels. Even if we say the work is too hard, they tell us to keep trying. I am also part of the green team at my school. We meet once a week to decide how we can make better better the school. One thing that we do is daily recycling. We made teams with students and staff to share the duties so that the recycling got done. During the fall, we watched two monarch butterflies go through the butterfly life cycle. It was so amazing to see the caterpillar turn into a butterfly. Lastly, I want to tell you about my favorite thing at school. We have a bearded dragon as a school pet. I love holding him and feeding him. I also enjoy cleaning out his cage to make sure he has a clean habitat to live in. Thank you for your time and have a great evening.
Nice job, Andre. That's pretty cool. Pretty cool. Good job. Nice job, Andre. Next time you're down here, bring the dragon, too. You notice he's sitting not only play, but he likes to clean the cage and take care. Way to go, Andre. Conservatory of the Arts, speaking of creativity, is in the house. And Jada Stokes, Teneri Pacheco, Delise Lopez, Genesis Ortiz, Alexa Nopoles. If I said your name wrong, please correct me. Accompanied by a principal, Mr. Sacker himself, Ryan Kelly. Mark, Mr. Energy himself, Marcos Carreras, the music teacher. Come on down. And nice to see you, Professor Silver, also, too. Silver, very good to see you.
High energy, very, very high. The kids, yeah. Happy Valentine's Day.
Happy Valentine's Day.
So I'll speak on behalf of the students while they sit up. Hello, my name is Marcos Carreras. It's my first year in the Springfield Public Schools, one of the greatest jobs I've ever had. So thrilled to be speaking on behalf of the Springfield Conservatory of the Arts. Thank you for the brand new building that we'll be moving into in the new school year. We have amazing principals in Ryan Kelly and our assistant principal, Rachel Centauri, and working for Ms. Warwick and for Lydia Martinez has been a dream come true. We are Varsity Bomba. We rehearse twice a week for an hour after school. We have been performing in Holyoke and other places in Springfield, and we are dedicated solely to the music of Bomba, so Afro-Cuban and music of Puerto Rico. We got to work with two Grammy winners, Latin Grammy winners, Jose Valentino and Ryan Gunderschmider. In the fall, we will be doing a special on WGBY in March, so keep an eye out for that. And we just love to play. So we're going to let our music do the talking for us, and it's really a pleasure to be back in Springfield. Love the city.
Pleasure
so here we go.
Okay, kids, let's rock and roll. Let's bomba. Everybody get up and bomba. Okay. That was good.
I'd also like to thank the Puerto Rican Cultural Center, who does our collaboration, Professor Silva from Elms College, coming to join us. So thank you, Puerto Rican Cultural Center.
Professor Silva, always good to see you. Okay. Last but not least, award-winning Zanetti Montessori School is in the house. I know that Principal Clark is here, and Miss Fizette herself, Susan Snow, is here, and Hope Christian Clark, Chef Tell is here, Maggie Kazimarski, please correct me if I say your name wrong, Milan Blanton, and Charlie Kazimarski, Charlie K. So how do you pronounce that last name properly? I want to make sure I get it right. Kazimarski, I was close. Okay. Let's give him a round of applause. How are you, Hope?
Good evening, Superintendent Warwick, Mayor Sarno, and members of the school committee. My name is Hope Christian Clark, and I'm currently in eighth grade at Zanetti Montessori School. At Zanetti, we live by the pillars of careness, fairness, respect, responsibility, trustworthiness, citizenship, and throughout the year, we have events to boost these pillars, promote kindness, and fundraise for different co-curriculars at Zanetti. So within the spirit of the month of February, the Student Council is having a February Valentine's Day cookie sale. Valentine's Day is known to represent a day of love and compassion. So within Zanetti, we are making someone's day just a little bit sweeter by offering people to send their friends cookies on Valentine's Day. Throughout this month, Valentine's Day cookies have been rolling in. The Student Council has been making cards, tying ribbons, and making delicious cookies to prepare for this day of smiles. Today, we distributed more than 500 cookies to peers and grades in honor of celebrating kindness and appreciation for your friends, teachers, staff, and school. Children smile, people laugh, and this being an annual event at Zanetti, anticipation always arises when there is a knock on your classroom door and a bountiful basket of cookies is spilling out just waiting to be delivered to the recipient. With the funds received, all the money goes to making Teachers Appreciation Day in May even more special for them. This may include making crafts, mugs, cards, school supplies, or anything to bring a smile onto their face. Besides the Valentine's Day cookie sale at Zanetti, the Zanetti Student Council has immersed itself into being involved in the community. In this upcoming March, we will be doing our Pennies for Patients Drive, where each classroom will get a box to collect pennies to support the Leukemia Foundation, this being dear to our hearts, for we have had students dealing with the struggles of leukemia. This past November, we collected cans through Rock 102 for the Springfield Open Pantry. We are proud to report that we were able to collect $1,526 worth of food. This past weekend, our custodian, Mr. Harris, put on the 6th annual Black History event at Zanetti. During this event, we celebrated dance, music, fashion, and all aspects that make up a culture. Mr. Harris and his family and friends were able to feed more than 250 people, and it was truly a great event. In conclusion, the Zanetti Student Council is trying to make Zanetti a better community, and we wish you all a happy Valentine's Day. Thank you very much.
Nice job, Hope. All right, Maggie.
Hello, my name is Maggie Kazimarski, and I'm an eighth grader at Zanetti Montessori School. I've been at this school for my whole school career, and I have participated in many different fundraisers throughout the years, helping my community for as long as I can remember. This year, the eighth graders have stepped it up from pizza sales, cookie orders, Polar Express movie, third grade buddies, and running the whole school peace day for the younger students at our school. Through our Polar Express movie fundraiser, we have raised enough funds to cover the down payment and bus fees for our annual eighth grade trip to High Meadows with money to spare. Tonight, I'm going to tell you about our Polar Express movie event. The Polar Express fundraiser held at our school was thought of, planned, and organized by Hope Clark, Maya Lauterbach, and me, Maggie Kazimarski, and our fellow eighth graders. We thought of this idea one day and thought it would be an amazing fundraiser, sparking interest within the hearts of our students. We spoke to our principal about it and concluded that we, the eighth graders, would lead this project. It was very hard planning for three young eighth graders, but we managed to figure it out with the guidance from a few of our teachers. In the end, we were able to design a flyer, talk to local stores and organizations for donations, plan a schedule for movie times, make popcorn drinks and snacks, and get our fellow eighth graders excited and involved. In just 3 weeks, we turned our gym into a winter wonderland. The next school-wide peace day in our school is for the younger grades. As middle schoolers, the task of planning and supervising these activities was presented to us, and we decided to take on the responsibility. We planned many different activities, some of which included board games, arts and crafts, and an obstacle course created by one of our eighth graders, Hope Clark. We are very excited for this event to take place next month. All in all, this is a great year for the Zanetti eighth grade. taking action and leadership roles in our community. And I have to say, I am proud to be a part of it. Thank you for your time.
Nice job, Maggie.
Hi, everyone. My name is Charlotte Kosmerski, and I am in the sixth grade as Zanetti Montessori. I'm going to talk about the Washington, D.C. trip at our school. This trip is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for the middle school students to go down to Washington, D.C. and explore and learn about our country's history. This trip is an opportunity for the middle schoolers to learn about our history and supplement what we learn in school using hands-on activities. When we go to D.C., we will visit many sites, including the Lincoln Memorial, the Vietnam Memorial, and the changing of the guards at the Arlington Cemetery, and much more. There will be lots of times to hang out and laugh with your friends, take pictures, and enjoy the sight. This trip will be costly, but it is worth it. We have many fundraisers going on right now to help subsidize the cost. If the students cannot pay the full price at once, there are many different payment plans to choose from. I am personally excited to see the changing of the guards at the Arlington Cemetery and the Lincoln Memorial. Recently, my class and I were reading an article about Martin Luther King Jr.'s I Have a Dream speech, which he presented in front of the Lincoln Memorial. It will be very special to visit that same spot where it celebrates one great American president and reminds us of another American hero. Overall, the middle schoolers who are participating in this trip are very excited to go on the trip. Thank you for your time.
Nice job, Cheryl.
Hi, my name is Milan Rosa Blanton. Zanetti participates in three sports, soccer, basketball, and volleyball. The girls have been very successful with our soccer team, concluding as undefeated. Within the girls' basketball season, we have played undefeated so far. Though they started out with a rocky start, the boys have been pretty successful within their soccer and basketball season. The past years in volleyball have gone great, and we are excited to play this spring. Zanetti is all about finding the right motivation. However, our priority is our grades, so sports are an award for keeping our grades up. When it came time to choose an extracurricular to do at Zanetti, there were a few things that drew me to join Zanetti Sports. Being in middle school, my years are coming to an end, and I felt it is necessary to make some memories, collaborate with friends, and I felt that the Zanetti Sports team was a perfect fit. The Zanetti sports community's positivity and characteristics have not only impacted the team, but also the rest of the Zanetti community. From the leadership skills to the collaboration, the Zanetti sports team have taught both the team leaders and the students. Thank you for your time.
Nice job. Nice job, Zanetti. Thank you. Thank you, kids. Oh, Hope, you're back.
Yeah, I'm back. So finally, to celebrate Valentine's Day in the spirit of friendship and compassion, we would like
swag.
To give you our own special treat and a little taste of Zanetti.
Thanks, Hope. Did you bake the award-winning chef? We like swag. Okay. Thank you very much. I want to shake your hand. Thank you. Thank you so much. Well, we might have to take a minute cookie break. That's great. Thank you very much. Thank you. That concludes the middle school students' speak out. You're more than welcome to stay. We'll take a 1 minute recess, then we'll go into our formal meeting. Happy Valentine's Day. How are you, young lady? I am addressing you. I said it that way. I know.
The music turned down.
You had to check that?
Yeah.
The music turned down your presentation. The vibration.
Yeah.
Kids were terrific, huh?
Yeah, you were good. evening, we'll call the meeting to order. We'd like to wish everybody a happy Valentine's Day. We had little props here, too. Happy Valentine's Day. And as I said, I give a shout out to my wife and my beautiful daughters, Cassandra and Kiara, Carla. Happy Valentine's Day. Love you all. And we'll do it again as we did in the middle school speak out. It is a lovely young lady's birthday today. Our great and very, very personable school committee woman, Latonya Naylor's birthday. So we're going to start with happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Latonya. Happy birthday to you. She'll get even with me on that, but we want to wish her a happy birthday. Madam Clerk, could you please call the roll? Present. For the record, Delfina Zigwadi, who's our great school representative from Renaissance, is absent. She's always very helpful here. She's at senior night at the cheerleading for the girls' basketball team, so good luck. With that, if we could all please rise for a moment of silence and the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much. Okay. With the indulgence of the school committee, we have quite the contingent here from the award-winning Harena School, and if there's a motion on the floor, we will take them out of order. This is to recognize, if there is a motion on the floor, motion by vice chairs or second?
Second
by everybody, so thank you very much for your indulgence. This is to recognize Harena School for their outstanding academic achievement, and I also want to put a sidelight in working with school committee woman Maria Perez and Superintendent Warwick and Pat Sullivan and my city team that I've directed the schematic design to start on dealing with the membrane and the I-91, the bridge there, even if it's MassDOT, as we continue to move forward to work with the state. And I appreciate school committee woman Maria Perez's efforts in this. We've sunk a lot of money in there, and you've done a tremendous job. And that's why we want to honor you tonight, and we're hopeful the state and others will come through so we can continue the success at Harena School. With that, I'll turn it over to Superintendent Warwick, and he will lay the groundwork for this. Ms. Perez, did you want to say something for me?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. We'll take that.
That was succinct.
Yeah. Superintendent Warwick, please.
Thank you, Mayor. I just wanted to, we said we'd be bringing schools down to recognize the schools that really exceeded all of our expectations with the new accountability system, and Harena did just that. Principal Cindy Escribano was here, and many of her teachers, but when you look at the accountability system, the school met all of their targets. Their progress percentage was 86%. The average in the state was way under that. But probably the best line on it was the bottom 25% of the kids in the accountability system achieved at 93%, making their progress percentage, which is unbelievable. So just incredible results, and it speaks to the quality of the leadership at the school and the quality of the teachers, the students, the parents, and it's a real community effort, but just incredible results. Cindy's done a great job since she's been there in leadership, so I'd like to bring her up to talk about what they've done at the school. But you can see from the great turnout of staff here tonight the kind of support and coherent team we have. But just absolutely incredible results for a school that used to be a level 4 school that has had some academic challenges in the past, but not anymore. This new accountability system is very tough. This was on the toughest test that's given in the country, and the results were absolutely outstanding, and we're proud of each and every one of you, and from the bottom of my heart I want to say thank you for the great job you've done.
Thank you.
Madam Principal, if I could say before you start with your lovely sidekick, can the staff, the administration, and teachers of Horena School please stand up?
Oh, you beat me to it.
Madam Principal, the podium is yours.
Thank you. So, good evening, Mayor Sano, Superintendent Warwick, and distinguished school committee members. It is such an honor to be recognized by Springfield School Committee for all the hard work and dedication that our team has put in at Horena. This success is a collaborative effort that comes from teachers, putting in extra hours to prep for the day, counselors and paraprofessionals that take the time to know each student. Excuse me. I'm sorry, I lost my spot.
It's okay.
Ah, thank you, Elaine. See why I brought her with me? And the students who come in every day to be a better version of themselves, of the person they were yesterday. And lastly, the parents who believe in the partnership and work with the Horena family to ensure that their child is a valued member of this community. I am so proud of everyone, of every individual on our team. But I would like to take a minute and allow a special student at the podium, Elaine Rodriguez Santana, to share her Horena experience with you all this evening.
Okay.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Elaine Rodriguez, and today I will be talking about how my school has improved. There are many different ways that my school has gone up in progress, such as teachers creating a better learning environment for their students. Also, teachers help their students improve and get better grades, and teachers make sure that the students have a good understanding of what they are learning. One way that our school has increased student performance is how the teachers produce a better learning environment for the students. One example of this is how the teachers set up the classroom to make sure each of us have a place to focus, work, and interact with each other. We sit at round tables instead of desks so that conversing with our peers regarding what we are doing is an important part of learning. Another example of this is how the environment enables us to collaborate and persevere through rigorous learning examples. Many students have improved and gotten better grades at Horena. For example, many students might have a low grade when they first start a new grade, but by the end of the year, they will have a better grade and a better understanding of everything they have learned throughout the year. Another example is how the students might not know what they are learning, so the teachers will make sure that the students understand their work and know what they need to do. Also, in our school, we have a lot of technology that helps both the students and the teachers. Every student has their own computer. Every classroom has a small board, Elmo, and a printer. Also, there are many different websites that the students use to help them improve. We use websites like Edulastic, iReady, and Prodigy. The students also use websites like Office 365 and Teams to complete assignments and share the work with their teachers. At Horena, students are hard workers and always strive to be the best they can. The teachers hold students accountable to do what they can, to do the best they can. I have been at Horena for 6 years, and I will never forget the staff there. There are many things that I will never forget about the school, such as PBIS events, celebrations, and our annual author's parade. I have 4 months left in fifth grade at Horena, and I'm going to enjoy every minute of it. Thank you.
Great job.
I just want to say thank you again to some of the team members that came tonight from Horena, because without them, the work that we do is not possible. So I would like to give them one final round of applause for everything that they do every single day.
Well, Madam Principal, don't go anywhere. And your sidekick, come on back up. Come on back up. I'm sure that school committee members have something to say, and then we have a little something for you all, and we'd be honored for each and every one of you to come up when we give the plaque to shake your hand. So I'll open the floor to our school committee members. I know they have some comments to say. Ms. Perez.
I have to say that it is demonstrated that when we work together and we support each other, we could make a difference. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Ms. Hirsch.
So you know I was not going to speak because my son attends Herena, and I say to all of you that you have exceeded my expectations and my husband's expectations. We probably could have sent our son just about anywhere, and we are so happy that we chose you all and that you treat him with an inordinate amount of respect and that you keep him accountable because he's like his father, Mayor.
What?
I hope Justin's watching on that one.
However,
we
are just so thrilled. I mean, from the responsiveness of your teachers, from your staff, Miss Fancy, everyone is just been so great. And I see Miss Santiago sitting there, and she had little Justin from when he started in pre-K. And we're just so happy that Jack will be there too, hopefully in September. So thank you for all that you do. You make not only a difference in my son's life, but in his peers and our community. Oh. And it's appreciated.
That's quite a testament. Can't put a price tag on that. Thank you, Ms. Hirsch. Any other school committee members?
Mayor,
Vice Chair Collins?
It's been said hundreds of, you know, not hundreds of times, but it never can be said too much. We've got some of the best teachers in the country sitting right in this room and and throughout our system. And it takes good leaders to allow them to do what they do and to be there, to be the facilitator for them. Show me a good principal who understands that. We'll show you a good school. We so appreciate everything you do for our schools, and we hold you all in the highest of regards.
Again, to Madam Principal and your lovely sidekick, and to the staff and administration, teachers, and the everybody, and the families and students. Many a times they say, you know, things can't be done. Or they used to say, yeah, what do you expect at Springfield? More and more people are now saying, what about Springfield, and why not Springfield? And it all keys to our schools. The schools are the foundation that builds, whether on economic development, on public safety, on being good people. And it's a tremendous acknowledgement. And as Superintendent Warwick had stated, the percentages that you increased by, well ahead of the state average. And again, we take everybody and anybody. So it's quite a testament. And to Vice Principal Fancy, my best to Captain Fancy out there. Good health to him too. So with that, we have, I don't have any cookies like Zanetti had for you, but we have from Springfield Public Schools, Springfield, Massachusetts, the Springfield School Committee Superintendent of Schools hereby recognizes Herena Community School for its outstanding academic achievement presented on this 14th day of February 2019 by all school committee members and signed by myself, Mayor Dominic Sarno, and Superintendent Dan Warwick. Congratulations, and really, we'd like to have all of you come down. We'd have the honor and pleasure of shaking your hands and say thank you. Congratulations. Pushing the ticket a little bit different. Whoa.
I was assistant principal down there, and she was still there then.
Well, you look much better than he does.
I guess you opened yourself up on that one.
So much. Well, thank you for keeping me back. Thank you. Well, we're glad
glad to have you. I know superintendent.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Helena. Okay, I want to thank the school committee for their indulgence in taking that out of order. We will go back to the agenda, and section two is to approve the minutes of the January 17, 2019 regular school committee meeting and the January 31st, 2019 school committee working session. Any questions or comments?
So moved.
Motion by Attorney Murphy. Is there a second? Second by Ms. Naylor. Roll call. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you. This is section three, items requiring a vote of the school committee. A is to approve White Street Elementary School travel to Red Gate Farm in Ashfield, Massachusetts, May 21st to May 22nd, 2019. That's my alma mater, White Street School. Superintendent Warwick?
Thank you, Mayor. There's a field trip form in your packet on this. It's approving a trip. We've done this trip several years at several schools. Great trip. Recommend approval.
Any questions or comments? Motion by Ms. Hurst. Second. Second by Ms. Gresham. Roll call vote is required. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Yes, Mayor, I went to kindergarten there. The school still looks the same.
we got to work on that, then.
May I ask one question? I'm
yes.
Perhaps it's just a typo. Sure. The date of the trip is 5:20, but they returned on 1:23.
That's a long trip.
Oh, okay.
No, it's supposed to be a typo. Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Hurst. See, we go back to White Street School. Mr. Flanagan, God rest his soul, used to get us out of class to clap. Clap the erasers against the school
board.
We did them on the side of the building. With all the whiteboards you have now and all the computers, was clapping the erasers, and we'd be all dusted there. Those are the good old days, huh? So we have a motion on the floor. Motion by Ms. Naylor. Again, it was her second. Yeah, we did that. No, I don't think we had an official. Do we have it? Okay, all right. Maybe I clapped too many erasers here. I'm sorry. Okay. It's been a long day. Okay. B, we'll go to approve. Yes, Ms. Nev.
Over here. I actually wanted to say something.
Go ahead.
Well, White Street is, everybody knows I love White Street. So two of my children go to White Street, and my son did go on this trip, and my daughter is going on this trip. And I actually went there to Redgate Farm, and it was just a phenomenal experience, and it was separate from White Streets that I was able to go, but it's such a phenomenal educational experience, and I know we have other schools that are also doing this. I'm hopeful that we'll have more schools that will be able to really engage in this phenomenal educational experience. So thank you to White Street for keeping this going on, and Mr. Healy, who is going to be there for all 3 days with those children. God bless your heart.
All 3 days.
Six months?
Thank you, Ms. Naylor. Any other questions or comments? We already voted on it. Thank you very much. B is to approve Dryden Memorial students travel to Redgate Farms in Buckland, Mass. From May 13th through the 15th, 2019. Superintendent Warwick?
Yeah, there's a form in your packet on this as well. Same trip, but for Dryden Memorial School. Recommending approval.
Any questions or comments? Hearing none, is there a motion on the floor? Motion by Ms. Naylor. Is there a second? Second by Ms. Gresham. Roll call vote is required. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Gresham? Yes. Naylor?
Yes.
Ms. Gresham?
Yes.
Mr. Murphy?
Yes.
Ms.
Yes. More sufficient votes. Matter passes.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you very much. C is the revisions to the Springfield Public Schools wellness policy. This is the first vote. Superintendent Warwick, please.
Thank you, Mayor. This has been through our subcommittee, our curriculum and program subcommittee. I know Denise wanted to speak to it. We also have some folks from our department that are here if anyone has any questions.
Ms. Hurst, I don't know if you want to
Denise, did you?
If you have any comments on it.
No, but it just was reported out favorably.
Yeah.
Thank you, Ms. Hurst.
So it was recommended by the subcommittee. We have Steph is here and Michelle, in case anyone has any questions on it. Subcommittee recommended it.
I do have
Ms. Naylor?
Something that we did talk about in the subcommittee was the fact that, and maybe I misunderstood, so I want to make sure I get clarity before we vote, that the students would not have access to anything other than healthy products during the school day. So with what I saw with Zanetti and knowing that a lot of our schools are doing bake sales to make money to fund field trips and things like that, I need to better understand how that's going to affect their ability to do that, because we know that they already have limited resources already.
Jeff? Thank you, Mr. Nelson.
So, did you take that? The PTO can still do bake sales for adults and that kind of thing. We just can't do what we used to do with the kids in the school because of all the allergies.
So for example, like the Zanetti bake sale.
If it was a PTO bake sale that they're running and selling to adults, that would be fine to raise money like they've always done.
So basically, so if we approve this policy, then we're saying that they have to figure out another way to raise money because they won't be able to do bake sales or lollipops or anything during the school day with students. That's why I wanted to get clarity, because I know it came up, and at first we thought, wow, that's a really good idea, but now after looking at the fact that many of these students are doing this to raise money, I'm really concerned about taking another opportunity for them to now fundraise in their classrooms or for field trips, especially with having so many students in poverty, unfortunately, that just can't afford to go on these trips.
May I ask you a question?
Ms. Hershey.
Number of hours after the school day.
30 minutes after the school day. So the PTO can still do things in the evening?
But these are not PTO fundraisers. These are school fundraisers that the city council, the student government is doing, and they're doing it during the school day. So that's what I want to understand.
Mm-hmm. The federal law doesn't allow us to allow competing food sales in schools to kids. It's against our school lunch program, and it jeopardizes all our funding for the school lunch program. If the other products are being sold to kids that don't meet the school lunch guidelines, it's called competing food sales, and there's a federal law against it.
So are there any more bake sales taking place in schools? And if so, are they happening during the school day, or are they happening after school? Like when we've gone for what's that called? Oh my gosh.
30 minutes after the school day is when they should be taking place.
Right.
Parent-teacher visit?
Open house. So, I've gone at open house, and they have PTO, and they can do it at that time.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Because it's not during the school day.
And that's how most PTOs raise their some of the way they raise their money with other fundraisers, right?
But what about what LaTonya's saying? Would the student government be able to do it during the day?
Not during the day, no.
We're prohibited by federal law from doing it during the day. We could get in trouble and lose all our school lunch funding, $23 million.
Even though a student's doing it and not adults initiating it, or the school initiating it?
You're not allowed to have any sales of food. They're called competing sales, competing with school lunch, and it's we're prohibited under it. By taking the school lunch money, we promise not to allow other food sales during the day to kids.
Okay.
Mayor, can I?
Attorney Murphy?
I'm sorry.
Did the subcommittee look at other options to just forfeit that all those monies that is going to be missed out for the purpose of fundraising for trips? What other options could be taken?
Right. So there are things that you jump-a-thons that you can do. You can do pencils. There are other ways to generate revenue aside from food items.
Okay.
So we're looking at shifting to non-food items instead of incentivizing students with sugary snacks and food.
Which is the way typically most of the PTOs raise most of their money the other ways anyway.
Attorney Murphy, you haven't spoken yet.
Thank you, Mayor. If we sell brownies and cookies, students were to sell that during the school day, we're going to lose $23 million in federal funding. That sounds a little extreme, don't you think?
I would presume if you were caught, though.
I just don't find that to be... likely to occur.
It's a condition of the program.
Many times when the kids are buying, selling cookies, brownies, whatever it is, they're not selling it to children, right? They're selling it to to bring home to give to their parents or their family members or, you know, they're not.
Question on that, to point to Attorney Murphy, is it, and I know having daughters that have peanut and nut allergies,
right,
that we run into that, into that issue, and if, say, somebody in the goodness of their heart does it, and there was an indirect ingredient in that, and it, where did it emanate from? It came from XYZ school, so I know that's, you know, so with the EpiPen.
So just to follow up on.
I'll go back to Attorney Murphy, but I'm just saying that.
Mayor, that's correct, that part of these guidelines, not only is it for good nutrition and not selling sugary items, sugar cookies and things like that during the school day, but it's also a quality control issue, particularly with the numbers of students who have food allergies. Foods that are brought in from another source other than Sodexo or other than a packed lunch that has been monitored by the district or the individual school building could create a danger for students with food allergies. So we need to be really careful about monitoring that. There is a competitive food section in the policy, and that's where it is tied into the school lunch program.
Let me, Attorney Murphy, I get the point of, so the floor is yours before I go.
No, thank you, Mayor. Okay.
Let me go back to Ms. Hurst, I'm sorry.
Like, for example, when Zanetti spoke earlier today and for their winter carnival, because it's after the school day, will they then be able to sell?
Yes.
And so it doesn't have to go through the PTO.
No, it doesn't have to. Typically in the evening when you have the evening meetings, most of the things are really run by the PTO with the student council, but it would have to be after school.
Okay,
the restrictions are 30 minutes after the
okay,
school.
So Zanetti, if they sold these after school at their winter carnival, they wouldn't be in any violation and neither would we?
Not for the competitive foods. No.
Oh, thank you.
I don't know. If it's a good cookie, we might want to blow that $23 million, you know? I'm kidding. It's a joke. Yeah. And the other, the good point that for clarification, Ms. Naylor brought up. Any other questions or comments?
Just two, Mayor.
Vice Chair Collins.
Go ahead.
When you talk about these restrictions, are these federal restrictions? Are these federal laws that we're complying with?
School lunch program is a federal program.
And so, not to belabor it, but it's okay to sell potentially, you know, hazardous cookies 30 minutes after the school day, but you can't do it during the school day?
Well, we wouldn't market them that way, Murphy.
Well, I mean, that's what, you know, they're saying, you know, peanuts.
Well, the idea would be most of those events would have, their parents would be there with them making a choice on something like that because of all the allergies and everything.
And you usually...
Well, I don't think it would be very advisable to have just children come back to an event and be selling them these products because of all the allergies.
Wouldn't they strongly advise against it? If they say they did, at following all the requirements, wouldn't they usually have signage that these items might contain peanut or nut? Okay. Sure.
If, for example, lollipops, right? And the school's selling lollipops, and they purchase them during the day, but they don't get them until the end of the day to take home, is that still okay?
30 minutes after the school day is when we can start to sell.
So they have to wait and have their parents come and pick it up. No, I mean, I'm joking about it, but it's really, I mean, when you think about it, if a school or, you know, a grade or whatever is raising $1,000 off of a bake sale, and then we turn around and say, oh, well, now you can't raise the money and we're not going to give you the $1,000, now you can't go on their trip, I feel guilty about that. So I think it really puts the onus on us as a school committee to think about how do we come up with strategies to help undergird these fundraising efforts for our schools if we're then saying we have to restrict them in another way from being able to fundraise for their different programs and for the families that are not able to afford many of these trips.
Thank you, Ms. Naylor. Michael, this is like a Laurel and Hardy episode you could write on.
What's been happening for the last
This is your lead. Lollipop conspiracy. Good points.
Don't write no more bake sales because they can still run bake sales. And really, the PTOs, the principals and the teachers work with the PTOs to help with the fundraising. And you can raise a lot of money that way to help subsidize these trips.
That's
so that still is available to folks. That's where you're going to earn the most of your
clarification,
money.
Clarification, yeah. Ms. Snail. Vice Chair Collins here?
Just two things, Mr. Mayor. One of the advantages of being a dinosaur is the biggest fundraiser of the year used to be the bake sale on Election Day.
Yeah,
when these laws changed, those all disappeared. Right. So having been in the schools at that time, I remember it. And that's unfortunate, but that's the way the rules are. The other thing is, if this policy passes this evening, it will go to a second reading. No, it won't, because it's not a revision, right? It's a new policy.
No, I think this was a revision, and it's going to require a second vote, so I think you were right on that.
That's not, actually, I wasn't looking for clarification of that. Within the policy, it calls for the creation of a committee, and one of the people to serve on that committee is supposed to be a school committee person, so if anybody on the committee has interest in serving on that committee, would you please let Patty know?
Absolutely.
It's actually an existing committee, the Wellness Policy Committee, and in fact, the policy revisions are a result of meetings from the standing committee. And there are certain slots in the committee, one of which is for a school committee member. It hasn't been filled for the last couple of years. So I spoke with Vice Chair about seeing if anyone was interested.
We used to sell, I remember Conway, I used to do carnation and rose sales we did.
Yeah. Pencils, they did other things.
And then Chris is right, because during election time, when you hit every school, you're $5, $5, what they took, so it was, but we used to do carnation. Right, Maria D? Was carnations and roses we sell out of the cafeteria.
Central, the green ones on St. Patrick's.
That's right.
So will we volunteer after the meeting, or? Because I would be more than happy to volunteer to be.
I would have made book on that, Latonya.
Could you tell if I've been back and forth?
Okay.
Thank you.
Well, listen, it was good to get these points out. So Ms. School Committee Woman Latonya Nair indicated that she would like to volunteer or be on that committee. So if there's no other questions or comments.
Move the question that we approve.
Motion by Vice Chair Collins. Is there a second? Second by Ms. Hurst. Roll call vote is required. Madam Clerk, please call a roll.
Ms. Gresham? Yes. Ms. Miller?
Yes.
Brett?
Yes.
Yes.
Ms.
Hurst?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. More than sufficient votes, the matter passes. Thank you very much. D is to approve the adoption of a Safe Routes to School Physical Education curriculum for grade 2, Barrels Buddies Safe Routes to Schools. And we did receive a number of support letters from community members and advocates on this policy. We appreciate those letters of support. Superintendent Warwick, please.
Thank you, Mayor. This also went through our subcommittee for curriculum and programs. Michelle and Maria are here if anyone has any questions about it that could go over it. And I don't know if Denise, you wanted to speak to it.
Ms. Hirsch?
It's going to teach our children how to safely get to school, use crosswalks, and things of that nature. So thank you. And that it came out of subcommittee favorably.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments?
I think it was Ms. September. Perez? It was part of the all-day the safe school.
Mm-hmm. And it was very eye-opening, even knowing the community itself, are the cautions that we have to have when it comes walking from to the home. And I'm just gonna say that I was very amazed by all the information, and I think it should be made more public of it, and have more of those walks with the community. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Perez. Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, is motion on the floor?
So moved.
Motion by Vice Chair Collins, or second?
Second.
Second by Ms. Naylor. Roll call vote is required. Madam Clerk, please call a roll.
Yes.
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 Yes. More than sufficient votes, matter passes. Thank you. E is to approve implementation of the Ready Mathematics program as a core curriculum resource for K-5 for the 2019-2020 academic year. Superintendent Warwick, please.
Thank you, Mayor. Stefania is here. If maybe you can give us a brief overview of the new program we're recommending for approval, and it's been through curriculum and programs led by Denise Hurst. But maybe, Stefania, if you could give us a brief overview of the program and the why and that kind of thing.
Thank you, Ms. Rochelle.
Sure. The Ready Math program that we want to implement in the upcoming school year and for the next six school years has been piloted in a few of the elementary schools. It aligns with one of the interventions that we've been using in all schools for the past year and a half. It also aligns to the new Massachusetts state standards for mathematical practices. Some of the other big components of it is that...
Stefan, if you don't mind if I can interrupt you. Mr. Dobbs, since I see you leaving, could you do us a favor, and if you have, just put it out on any of your media that we will be holding the meeting that was postponed to take public input next Tuesday.
On the budget.
On the budget. Yes. So if you could do that, that'd be helpful. Sorry, Stefania, but
that's okay.
And now
I wanted to grab it while I was here. No.
So some of the other pieces that do come with the new mathematics program is that there's online student practice, so the students that are taking home their computers have the opportunity to do an additional practice at home. There's editable worksheets. There's audio support for families who need it possibly read to them. There's enrichment. There's ELL and special ed supplements that go along with the program to support students that are either second language learners or need additional supports, as well as discourse cards. So in the schools, a lot of times we want to hear students speaking with each other. You don't want to hear a silent room. And so there's also support for teachers and students, so you'll hear more of the speaking of the mathematical language in the classrooms.
Thank you, Ms. Rochelle. Any questions or comments? Ms. Gresham.
Yeah.
And I did a little research after that, and according to edreport.org, they're not really in favor of this curriculum.
Actually, on the Ed Reports, it was the highest rated curriculum in math, and especially compared to the current one that we have now,
yeah,
as far as aligning to state standards and usability for teachers.
Yeah, when I looked under the alignment, which is the rating
mm-hmm.
part of it, right, it said that they partially met expectation. So I think we need, I would like to have a little bit more information on this curriculum if the chair of program and curriculum can.
Could you share that article so that we can all look at it?
Yeah, it's right. If you go on edreport.org, it'll give you all the information. Also, Education Week that is published monthly, it wasn't highly favored by them as well. So I think we should, you know, look at this again. If it's, I don't know what the policy is on that, on tabling a particular item and revisit through the subcommittee.
Is there? Thank you, Mr. Is there any way to, you know, with this age of computerization, any way to? Because you're saying you're quoting from the same study. Is there any way to double check that, or if not, we'll put it to.
Yeah. Also, under the usable, the three gateway 1, 2, and 3. When you look at the usable component of it, it says not applicable. So I just have some questions about this particular curriculum.
We can get you additional information on it. I don't
okay.
have that. You know, we did do the research on those reports. I just don't have it in this packet with me tonight.
Okay. All right. I would appreciate a little more.
Well, if there's any other questions or comments, is the indulgence of the school committee, or if there's questions or comments?
Well, if this is for the 1920 school year, so...
So we have...
It admits there's plenty of time to do that check, right?
Right?
So.
Okay.
Yes.
May I also ask, Mayor?
Yes, Ms.
We currently are piloting it now?
Correct.
And so do we have also the data that would have...
supported why we wanted to implement it? Like, did you see that there was growth or that there was progress?
So we have it in specific schools.
Schools.
As far as having a state assessment to align it with, they'll be taking the assessment come April.
So
we have internal assessments.
Yes.
Out of respect to school committee woman Gresham, this and the vice chair Collins has indicated, I'll ask Superintendent Warwick, this would not hinder any eventual move to this once it's been clarified. You have enough time?
Sure.
So if we appropriately put it back in subcommittee and then bring it back out after it's been clarified, Attorney Phelps?
So you'd have to table the vote?
Yeah.
And there would have to be a motion to table,
okay.
A vote on the motion to table, and then and you could combine it or do a separate motion to send it back to subcommittee.
Okay, is there a dual motion now, please?
Yeah, I'll make a motion that we table the vote until such time as it returns from quitting the program subcommittee after further study.
Okay, motion by Vice Chair Collins. Is there some clarification there, Ms. Rochella, before I go for a second?
I'm not going to, you know, we can pull it up later, but we have the report right here. But we can table it, and we'll do it at the next meeting.
Okay. Is there a Vice Chair Collins has a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Ms. Gresham. Roll call vote is required. Again, we look to bring this back ASAP as soon as it's clarified. Please call the roll, Madam Clerk.
Ms. Gresham?
Yes.
Yes, more sufficient votes, matter passes. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Ms. Gresham. Efforts to approve implementation of beginning a reader and making meaning in the first grade for the 2019-2020 academic year. Superintendent Warwick, please.
Yeah, Stefania's here to lead the discussion. We also have Laura and Kate here. We've implemented this in kindergarten, that we piloted in grade one, and we're recommending approval tonight. Maybe Stefania can give them a brief overview.
Thank you, Superintendent Warwick. Ms. Rochella?
Sure. We implemented it throughout the district last year in kindergarten, and we've piloted in grades 1 and 2 in multiple elementary schools, and we want to move it into the first grade throughout the whole Springfield Public Schools for the upcoming year.
Thank you, Ms. Rochella. Any questions or comments of the superintendent and or Ms. Rochella? Hearing none, is there a motion on the floor?
So moved.
Motion by Ms. Harris. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Ms. Perez. Roll call vote is required. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Yes.
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 Yes. Board of sufficient votes, matter passes. Thank you very much. G is to approve the seal of biliteracy program. Superintendent Warwick, please.
Thank you, Mayor. This opportunity came out with a new law, that look bill, and I know Carrie Martins is down here with Stefania to talk about it. So if you can give us a brief overview, it also came through curriculum and program subcommittee.
Thank you, Ms. Rochella. Ms. Martins?
I think this is a great opportunity for our kids, so I'm thrilled with the department bringing this forward.
Thanks. Hi, everyone.
Hi.
Into the 2017, a bill called the Look Bill passed, and part of that bill says that Massachusetts, by ruling of DESE, can create a seal of biliteracy. So what it does is it looks at any child who has a 240, will get you a regular seal of biliteracy on your MCAS ELA. If you have a 260, you can get a seal with distinction. So we take all the children who have a 240 or 260 and we give them a language assessment. If they pass that, we can now put a seal on their diploma and on their transcript that will certify them as being fully bilingual. So what's nice about it is that it changes, you know, from a deficit where you don't know a language to a positive. And these kids will then be able to put on their resumes, on their college applications, that they are fully biliterate and they are, it's endorsed by the Department of Education.
Thank you, Ms. Martins. Any questions or comments, Ms. Martins or Ms. Rochella? Superintendent Warwick, yeah, Ms. Naylor?
We did talk about this in subcommittee at length, and we were really ecstatic about this opportunity for our students. And particularly the part that I would like to elaborate on is just not for students who are Latino. It is for any student who speaks any language, and there are so many different languages that are spoken in our schools.
Yeah.
And so a lot of times people make the assumption that you're just talking about bilingual in the sense of Spanish speaking, but whatever it is, whatever you can think of, whatever the dialect, that is pretty awesome to really help students to really be confident in who they are and where they come from, and not be ashamed of who they are and where they come from, and for us to recognize that as an asset. So thank you so much for bringing this to the table, and I was ecstatic.
Thank you, Ms. Taylor. I think we had about 60, is it about 63 different languages spoken?
41.
It's 52, okay, I'm sorry, yeah, 52.
It's a lot.
Ms. Hirsch?
No, I was just...
Came through curriculum and programs, yeah.
To what Ms. Naylor just said, is that Ms. Martin also shared that we'll be able to have some cross-collaboration with other districts who might have someone who is able to, or is able to sort of assess and measure very difficult dialects that we might not necessarily always have access to.
Thank you, Ms. Hirsch. Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, is there a motion on the floor?
So moved.
Motion by Ms. Hirsch, is second.
Second.
Second by Ms. Naylor. Roll call vote is required. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Yes.
Ms.
Naylor?
Yes.
Ms.
Yes.
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 Mr.
Yes. Yes. Board of Sufficient Votes, matter passes. Thank you, Ms. Rochelle. Thank you, Ms. Martin.
Thank you.
H is to approve the AP Capstone Seminar and Research Courses. Superintendent Warwick, please.
But maybe Stefania and Ann Ferreter from our academic department
can
give us an overview. And it did come out of Curriculum and Program Subcommittee, too, so I didn't know if they'd want to speak to it. But you can give us a quick overview.
Thank you, Superintendent Ward. Ms. Ferreter, Ms. Rochella.
What we are proposing is approval of AP Seminar and AP Research Courses, which would be new to the district. They are under what's called the AP Capstone Program. If students successfully complete AP seminar, typically in 11th grade, and then research in 12th, because they are sequential, then and also take other AP courses, they can obtain the Capstone's diploma. If they only complete seminar and research successfully, they get a Capstone certificate, both of which are highly recognized and highly regarded by universities and colleges and so forth, much like the other AP courses that are offered here in the district. So typically it's 11th and 12th grade. Some districts started as early as 10th grade, which we're kind of in favor here. Central is online to start it next year with your approval. It will be connected to social studies, a contemporary U.S. history course, which starts post-World War II. There is an exam that they sit for after seminar. There is a fee for that, and it's $142 per student who takes the exam, but we get subsidized because of our students meeting the economically disadvantaged definition, so it would be far less than that. We're targeting 20, we hope we'll have at least 20 students at Central to start in September or August. SciTech and Putnam also have interest in this, and we think it would be great to add these courses. The seminar course delves deeply, and it targets those skills development, research, analysis, evidence-based arguments, writing, and presenting. So not only do they have to collaborate and do presentations that are graded, but they also have a writing component. In fact, in research, they have to complete a 4,000 to 5,000 word essay, and they have to give a defense of their project. So it's very, very rigorous.
Thank you, Ms. Ferreter. Any questions or comments?
Just a question.
Vice Chair Collins.
Thought I heard you say, Ann, that 20 per class is what or 20 students interested is what you have to have?
We'd like to have at least 20 in the first running of this AP seminar class at Central. And that would be the same if we can get it up and running at SciTech and Putnam.
I'm just concerned as we're changing the setup of our schools and we're ending up with smaller high school components like at Duggan and Renaissance, of that number when they only have 60 in a cohort, or maybe 120, I guess, if you're counting two grade levels. I want to make sure that these students could be availed of the similar opportunities, so.
Right. So ideally, in my mind, if we could get 30 children to sign on to take this course next year, it would be fabulous. We have a teacher lined up. He will be trained in this capstone
this summer. He has vast experience in AP prior to this capstone coming into being. He teaches a full load of social studies, so we were hoping to start, you know, to program one section of seminar, because it's going to take time to sell it to students as well. It will earn them AP credit, and it will count for social studies. But, I mean, ideally, if we had more teachers, we'd try to grow it. And ultimately, I think that would be the goal, Chris, is to get.
Yeah, as we're growing, I'm worried about these smaller high schools that we're creating now and making sure that they have the same kind of access to AP courses. And since it's taught during Central's school day, if you're across the town at Duggan, there's no way you can participate in that. So if we're looking down the road, can we look for avenues to, because sure, that's a growing component of our system now, where we're getting the 6 to 12 type of school set up.
Right, right.
It's very popular with parents. I don't see it shrinking. Mm-hmm. I see it perhaps growing. And we want to make sure we find a way to offer these kinds of things to students who would be in those settings.
Mm-hmm. Well, neither of these courses are, I should say, Capstone itself has no initial program fee. So, you know, beyond training the teacher and then having the children sit for that exam like they would for any other AP course, it's not, you know, it's not cost prohibitive in my mind. But I don't see why we wouldn't ultimately attempt to find ways to make it, you know, available to all of our high schools.
Yeah, I wasn't so much worried about the cost as if you've only got 100 students, that 20-student threshold in order to look at launching might be high for a school that's in that structure.
Is there a threshold? Is there a minimum threshold? Or are you just saying for the initial program you want to have at least 20, but not to start it at another school? Is there a minimum level? Am I correct? Because I believe...
Trained teacher.
Okay. So that would not be a problem then in that situation.
It becomes a problem when you're trying to staff the school, because it's... You got a teacher carrying a full load of history. You're going to have them do this course, and you've got 5 or 6 kids in let's say a Duggan.
Mm-hmm.
Now that teacher's taken up in one period and not available. Can you get all of the other students the education they need?
Okay,
and
I get
that's
what you're
what
saying.
That's where
saying.
My mind is. Staffing and scheduling schools. We need to think down the road about ways to try to
Absolutely.
Adjust that.
Absolutely.
Spoken
that makes sense.
Like a true principal. Any other questions or comments?
I would just say that it did come out of subcommittee favorably, and we thought it was really exciting to be able to add a course like this, just because, you know, it gives our students a real true experience at the rigor that they could potentially encounter as they go on to college, and even the experience of defending a dissertation, right, and what that would be like for them as they, you know, pursue higher graduate degrees.
And they are to be congratulated. I'm just asking a question, Donna. The number of AP offerings that Springfield has compared to other cities in this state is just unbelievable. Our kids have access way beyond wealthy kids in wealthy communities have. And congratulations for making sure that access is there for all of our kids. Mm-hmm. Job well done.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments? Okay, hearing none, there's a motion on the floor.
So moved.
Motion by Ms. Hurst, there's a second.
Second.
Second by Ms. Naylor. Roll call vote is required. Madam Clerk, please call the roll.
Yes.
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 Yes. Board of Official Votes, the matter passes. Thank you, Ms. Ferrier. Thank you, Ms. Rochella. Informational discussion items. We're now going to move to a kindergarten readiness presentation. I know Laura Kieran is here. Am I correct? Come on, Superintendent.
Laura Menz and Kate Asher Stefania Rochella. So.
Are
here. We talk a lot about preschool and preschool readiness for kindergarten. So we've been doing some kindergarten readiness assessments, and we'd like to share the results with you tonight. We showed just some similar results last year from our kindergarten readiness assessment, but it shows the positive effects of preschool on kindergarten readiness and speaks to that issue. And it also breaks reading down into some component areas where I think the data is very interesting. So if you can take us through.
Sure. So here's the kindergarten readiness report. We had produced it last year, and we had given you the data. And we want to keep the school committee abreast of what has occurred over the past year. And so we often talk a lot about the word readiness, and that there's many ways to discuss and look at readiness, such as the social emotional learning, executive function, etc. But the purpose of the community effort to strengthen grade level reading is very important. And so we're talking about just one component in this, and that's literacy readiness, often called pre-literacy skills. So this is what we look at for children entering kindergarten to see if they are ready to succeed. These questions are important as we look at the success of our collaborations and coaching, and for what supports we put into place to meet children where they are when they enter the kindergarten. So these are the questions that we ask ourselves. To what extent are SPS kindergartners entering kindergarten with age-appropriate early literacy skills? Is there a relationship between preschool experience and children's literacy skills as they enter kindergarten? The procedure that we take is that we look at results from the fall of 2018 when they take the KLA, and we match that information that the district collects about a child's preschool experience. And that's what a parent reports unless they are enrolled in one of our pre-Ks. And then we look at the sample. And the sample includes all children with a complete fall 2018 KLA, and we look at the available data on preschool experience, or about 96% of all entering kindergarten students, which this year is about 1,794.
Thank you, Ms. Rochelle.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So in Springfield Public Schools, our kindergarten literacy assessment is an internally designed assessment that we use to be able to document student progress throughout the early literacy over the course of the year. And the goal of proficiency is at the end of kindergarten. The assessment components are aligned to the predictors of strong early literacy skills, including print-related skills and oral language comprehension. Teachers use the student data tracked over time in the beginning of the year, the middle of the year, and at the end of the year to individualize instruction based on student needs and support the literacy development of their students. The KLA, the skills that are addressed in the KLA are the key components are letter knowledge, phonological awareness, concepts of print, consonant sounds, oral language, and word identification. These skills addressed are included on all three administrations in the fall, in the winter, and in the spring. These skills are necessary for a strong foundation so that making meaning and comprehension can be focused on as children develop and encounter age-appropriate texts. The document that you have in your packet, the report that you have, is measuring child readiness. And so for this analysis, we looked at the items that we thought we would expect students to demonstrate at entry level into kindergarten.
You don't have tip and mitten anymore. Mrs. Cabrini had that for us when we were at White Street School.
What about Dick and Jane?
Yeah, that too. Yeah, but I remember tip and mitten, Mrs. Cabrini, White Street School.
That, thank God.
They need a lot more, right?
I couldn't resist.
So here you're looking at how do SPS kindergartners perform on entry assessments in literacy? And you can see the five skill areas as they defined it as preschool level entry expectations. So some of the key findings is we found that about 6% of our students entering Springfield Public Schools as kindergartners met the early literacy expectations in all five identified skill areas. These findings remain pretty much unchanged over the last 2 years. They were 7% last year, 6% this year. And even in our former data, we found similar trends over the years. We encountered a similar finding with a concern that a low number of children enter ready in respects to literacy. The percent of children meeting expectations in component skills ranged, as you can see, from 16.6 in those consonant sounds area up to 41.3 in oral language, which is a big win for us.
Can I just, I want to make a point of information. The Superintendent Warwick and the school committee and the staff and administrator, we know we've been very aggressive in our pre-K agenda and opening up many, many hundreds and hundreds of more slots so we can get that overall number in partnering with such Head Start and Square One and the Y and our SPS up at the early childhood center. So I know people ask, well, what are you doing about it? We aggressively moving on that, so we're very hopeful that number will kick up. Thank you. I'm sorry.
Great. Thank you. All righty. So as Mayor Sarno was talking about, we are definitely exploring the relationship between our preschool experience and the literacy skills that those students hold as they enter kindergarten. And yes, children from Springfield Public Schools pre-K and center-based care had significantly higher overall KLA scores than those with no preschool experience at all. So as you can see, these are the average scores of the KLA by school preschool experience. Our kindergarten entry expectation would be about a 79.
Mm-hmm. May I ask a quick question? When you talk about the SPS pre-K, is there a breakdown between the full day and half day? Could we get that information at some point?
Sure.
That would be helpful to get a better understanding. And I mean, my assumption is the kids that are in full day are going to have higher scores. But obviously, it's always nice to have the data to back up what we're saying.
Yep.
Thank you.
Good point, Ms. Snell. Thank you.
It is a good point. And most of our center-based care as well has both full day and half day models. And okay. They are both significantly higher than those without the preschool experience. So our kindergarten point average for the entry expectation is 79, and as you can see, the graph in front of you, and so that translates to, in the report you'll notice that 9.5% of children from SPS pre-K met expectation in all areas, compared with 5.3% for the center-based care, 2.4% of their population in family child care, although that was very small, and 1.3% of the students with no known preschool experience. Interestingly, you'll notice the data here points to the public schools, and we have a large percentage of children with identified special needs, and our educators are actually able to move more children toward readiness during those hours of the day. Mm-hmm.
Schools other than the Montessori are half special ed kids and half regular ed role models. So you have to remember the special ed role models, the numbers would be different, but you can see the results are still better even taking that into account.
Just thinking about how we're pegging
So those are some of the things that we're doing. But, you know, really as we close, we find the day disheartening. And I think we all should. But we're here to continue partnering with the partners that we work with. Mm-hmm. We're all committed to working together to find better ways, innovative ways to help our kids in that birth to five space before they come to us. And really, I think it behooves us to really think about how we engage families, because that is the missing piece, right? And Latonya, you said it to me last year after this active meeting. How do we help families be educated around what their child's needs are in that space so that they come to school ready
than they currently
are? Questions for us?
Any questions or comments?
I just want to say thank you for everything that you're doing. I think the fact that it was 7% last year and it's 6% this year tells us that we're constantly in a situation where that gap of children being prepared for learning and what we have to do to get them where they need to be to be successful is growing, and it's unfortunate. So I think that the more that we think about creative ways of really getting families more engaged is really going to be the key for them to come in. But in the meantime, you're doing what you need to do to make sure that they're able to get where they need to be, and seeing these numbers is exactly what we want to see, that those growth rates. So thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Perez.
It'll change the percentile that's presented here tonight. I think that that's one of the things that will definitely help. And thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Any other questions or comments? Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Superintendent Ward.
Great report. And, it also makes you think of not only expanding preschool, but what we're doing with birth to three.
Yeah.
Because the kids are getting to the preschools so far behind. The preschool alone can't necessarily catch them up. So that's another space that we have to keep working with the community on. And this is a true community partnership and moving this forward. We've done a lot of work, but the news is sobering and we have more to do.
Yeah, we worked closely with the Davis Foundation and other entities.
We've done so much, and it's a significant challenge for us.
Yeah.
The good news of the work that we're doing and regardless of the situation.
Yeah. Thank you, Ms. Naylor. They'll cover the lollipop conspiracy.
Absolutely. We're going to be on our front page talking about lollipops and cookies.
We needed a little laugh. Reports of standing committees. A is student relations, parent concerns. Ms. Gresham?
No reports, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Ms. Gresham. B is Building and Maintenance Committee, Vice Chair Collins.
No report.
Thank you, Mr. Collins. C is Legislative and Contracts Committee, Ms. Perez.
No report.
Thank you, Ms. Perez. D is Curriculum and Programs Committee, Ms. Hurst.
Your Honor, many of the items that came through subcommittee were voted on this evening, and then we will return with respect to the items that we did table.
Thank you very much, Ms. Hurst. E is Budget and Finance Committee, Vice Chair Collins.
Yeah, the meeting we were going to have on Tuesday got canceled due to the weather. And just a point of clarification, this is a subcommittee meeting of Budget and Finance, not a full committee meeting, so I don't want people to come thinking that the full committee is going to be there. The state only requires us to hold a hearing once the budget's completed and to then give it out to the public and take some input, and then we have a short window to vote on it. We actually consider that, and I suppose I shouldn't use the term from my childhood, but I'm going to ask backwards.
Tip and mitten.
Yeah. Shouldn't you take input at the beginning?
Absolutely.
So we voluntarily hold a second meeting at the beginning of the process to take public input. It's not required by anybody in the state, but we do it that way. So that's what this meeting is.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Chair Collins, for doing that, too. Any questions or comments on that? Okay, we'll move to F is the Vocational Education Committee. Attorney Murphy? It's not technology. It's okay. Okay. That was for you, Norm. G is the Technology Committee. Ms. Naylor?
Not yet, but we will have a meeting in March.
Okay. You're always very active, too. H is the School Safety Committee. Ms. Gresham?
No report, Mr. Mayor.
Very active on that. And special subcommittee is a staff demographics, which is chaired by Ms. Perez.
Not yet, but we have no meeting in March.
Thank you very much. Okay, we'll now move to report of a student representative. Again, she's cheerleading for the girls basketball team tonight, so we'll look forward next time with Delfina. Report of the superintendent. Superintendent Warwick.
Thank you, Mayor. We're moving forward on the Homer DeBerry building project. It's really exciting news. We've completed designer selection, so our architect is now on board, and we were very, very fortunate to go down this week, meet with the MSBA. The MSBA has 13 votes relative to the choice, and Springfield had three, but our recommendation held, and we're going to be able to work with Danisco Design. They've been the most popular architectural firm in the state. They've had the best record, and we've worked with them on the Central Edition, and we're also working with them on the Brightwood project, so we're very excited about that. They've done an outstanding job with us, and that project is moving forward. Before this project, we've already exceeded $700 million worth of MSBA projects with the state. And with those projects, we get up to 80% reimbursement. I'd like to thank the school committee and the mayor, because the mayor's come forward as, with all these projects, there's a lot of bonding that the city has to do to move things forward. But our average building age is 55 years, and we're talking about, whether it was the Brightwood project or Homer Street, these schools are 120 years old that we're replacing. So really a huge step forward, and something I'm very, very grateful for. So I'm just ecstatic with the architect, because this group does an absolutely fabulous job, and it kickstarts the process so we can move forward with Homer DeBerry as well. There's a lot more work to be done, but we look forward to engaging with the school committee and the community in moving that project forward. It's going to be another exciting project. We talked about preschool today. Our proposal would have a significant preschool piece, special education piece, and so be very, very positive for the community. So very excited about that, and very grateful for the mayor with all of his support with it, because we submitted all the accelerated repairs in addition to these major building projects. So the city's really putting a lot of money into our upgrading our school buildings.
My pleasure, Superintendent Warwick, and I want to thank my CFO, TJ Plan. I want to also thank the City Council, which, because I have to put it across the City Council. And I know this is going to be, as we did with Lincoln Brightwood, with School Committee Woman Perez making that motion. I know Barbara, School Committee Woman Gresham, will look very forward when we make that official vote to lead the vote on that, too. But so making headway, hopefully we'll get some shovels in the ground in the very near future with that project. Superintendent Warren?
Going with Danisco, you save yourself 2.5 months worth of arguments about putting the gym on the second floor, so.
Save that. They lost that argument. We also save a lot of other arguments. The preschool design piece is done. The special education design is done. We don't have to start from scratch. It really jumpstarts the project for us, because they've worked with us. This is their third project working with us. So it's going to really kickstart things and move them forward. And they really are extraordinary to work with, and a very well thought of firm. So I couldn't be more excited and more grateful to all the support we've received with these projects. Really incredible. Some other good news, the arrest report. We always hear a lot. You can see the arrest reports in your packet. And for the entire year, we only have 28. Some years back, we were moving towards 1,000 a year. We're down to 28 for the whole year. So it's really incredible. And of that, only 17 in our regular schools. So the arrests are way down. So if anyone tells you other than that, this is the data and the facts. And I think the news is very, very good. And thank you to the police department for their extraordinary partnership with us on that. They've really done a great job. Another piece that's in your package is White Street School. We were talking about it earlier, Latonia, but Young Scholars Program and the scholarships they handed out. So I put an informational piece on that. We've given 10 White Street School students $3,000 scholarships earmarked for college. And I went through all the rooms at White Street last week, and absolutely incredible things going on. I got to talk to some great students, great teachers, and the work that's going on there is absolutely extraordinary. And lastly, there's a contracts report in your packet to review and give us any feedback on.
Thank you, Superintendent Warwick. Any questions or comments, Superintendent Warwick's report? Okay, hearing none, we'll move to unfinished business. Oh, I'm sorry, Ms. I'm sorry.
Oh, thank you, yeah. I was really excited when we were able to get him to come here. We saw him this summer during his presentation. It was extraordinary, and we reached out, and Stefania and her team were able to organize getting him in, and our administrators were thrilled with it. But thank you for school committee folks that were able to come by, but it was really a great presentation.
Thank you, Ms. Hurst, Superintendent Warwick. Unfinished business? Hearing none, new business? Hearing none, is there a motion on the floor to adjourn? Motion by Ms. Hurst, is there a second? Second by Ms. Naylor. All those in favor say aye. All those opposed, the ayes have it. Happy Valentine's Day. Thank you, good evening, and thanks for watching.
I was so thrilled about the Dinesco Choice, Mayor. They're incredible.